In the previous lecture, we discussed the famous, or perhaps the infamous, idea of the good. This is Plato's supreme principle. It's the supreme principle of reality, of being, and of knowledge, and of truth. It's a terribly obscure passage, as we saw. It's obscure not because the descriptions of it are so extraordinarily complicated. In fact, they're not. What they are is extraordinarily sparse. Socrates, in fact, tells us very little about the idea of the good. In the last lecture, I gave you a couple of speculations as to why Plato writes this scene in this way. Perhaps I suggested he's trying to provoke the reader into thinking for himself or for herself. Those were speculations and no more. Socrates himself acknowledges that this discussion of the idea of the good is obscure or is at least insufficient. His colleague, Glaucon, is puzzled. And of course, why shouldn't he be? It's a terribly puzzling description. So Socrates tries to help out. And he helps out by means of an image. The image that's become known by scholars as the divided line, which will be the focus of today's lecture. I need to warn you in advance that once again we will be in some murky waters. This is a very difficult passage to understand. It's again very sparse. When you read it on your own, you'll perhaps be surprised by how quickly it goes by, and you won't really be able to understand each and every move that Socrates makes. I'll do my best to try to explain. At the same time, I'll also have to do some interpreting in this passage. I'll alert you when I'm offering you some of my own views about how to understand the divided line. Socrates gives Glaucon instructions about how to draw a certain line. In ancient Greece, they had no blackboards, they had no projectors, so the line probably would have been drawn in the sand, right at their feet. So let's try to imagine these instructions being given to us. In fact, you could even follow these instructions yourself at home with just paper and pencil. Take a line and divide it into two unequal sections. Socrates doesn't tell us which of the sections, the top section or the bottom section, and notice I'm assuming that the line is vertical. We learn later that it is vertical, but actually here in this passage, Socrates doesn't even tell us that it's vertical. Again, however, we'll assume it is, and we get evidence for this later. We have our vertical line, we cut it into two segments, unequal segments. And then we cut each of the unequal segments again, following the same proportion of the original cut. What you have before you, if you have undergone this exercise with Socrates, is a line with four sections. We can label the top section A, then B, then C, and the bottom section can be labeled D. One of the things you'll notice right away on your drawing, even if you did it very quickly, is that the two middle sections, regardless of how you cut the line yourself, are equal. We can prove this. In the translation I use, that by Alan Bloom, in his notes, he shows you the proof. Whatever translation you are using, likely you'll find this discussion in the notes. The two middle sections are equal, and that turns out, on my interpretation of the divided line, to be very important. The line is vertical, therefore it has a left side and a right side. And Socrates labels each of these four segments and each side of the line. On the left side, we find objects. The objects are as follows, and you can follow this as I diagram it in the booklet that accompanies the course. If you're using Alan Bloom's translation, as I am, you'll see this is similar to the drawing he uses. Any translation, again, that you're using will likely have a figure accompanying this passage of the Republic. On the left at the top, this would be section A, are forms. In Greek, the word is eidē. You see that in the booklet. That's the plural of eidos. Section B, the second segment, mathematical objects. Section C, below that, sensible things. Section D, the very bottom on the left, images or icons. I pronounce that word, you see the Greek in the booklet, to remind you that's the root of our word, indeed, icon or image. On the right side of the line, corresponding to each of these four objects, is a psychological or cognitive state which is responsible for apprehending the object. Corresponding to forms on the left is intellection on the right. The Greek is pronounced noesis. Corresponding to mathematical objects on the right is thought, dianoia. Corresponding to sensible things is trust. In Greek, the word is pistis. And corresponding to images is imagination, eikasia. This is all very mysterious at this point. Let's try to figure it out. A very great scholar whose name was Jacob Klein, his work you'll find in the bibliography in the booklet, made a suggestion about how to understand the divided line, which I have long followed, and I will be imitating his argument in the way I present the material that I hope will elucidate the meaning of the divided line. Klein's suggestion is that the key to understanding the divided line is to start at the bottom with images. So let's think about images for just a couple of minutes. We need to think about images, D on the left at the bottom, in relationship to C, sensible things, which are above the images. The key point is this. An image is an image of something. Best example, the example Socrates himself uses, is a shadow. A shadow is an image of a sensible thing which is responsible for producing the shadow. An example that would come very quickly to our minds, of course, would be a photograph. If I take a picture of you with a camera, the picture is the image, you are the original. You are a sensible thing, a real thing, and the image is an image of you. I mentioned that this line needs to be vertical. And the reason why is because sensible things are higher than images. Now, what does higher mean? It means that images are dependent upon sensible things. If I remove my hand, there is no shadow. It doesn't work the other way around. If I cut off the light source, there's no shadow, but there's still a hand. The sensible original is responsible for the image. The image is dependent on the original. Klein's thesis, which I believe is accurate, is that this relationship between image and original works its way through the entire divided line. Let's move up to see what that means. Sensible things, my hand, the chair, the table, are themselves images of mathematical objects. In terms of the diagram that you have in your booklet, sensible things are segment C, mathematical objects, segment B. That is not an obvious description, is it, to say that sensible things are images of mathematical objects. In fact, it's a rather difficult move to understand. But let me offer you this suggestion, this example as a way of thinking about this. Let's just pick a number, the number 3. The number 3 is capable of counting 3 apples, or 3 oranges, or 3 grapefruits, or 3 tables. The number 3 remains the same. The number three is not something we can touch with our hands or see with our eyes. It's a concept. It's an intelligible structure. The chairs, the tables, the oranges, the apples, they can all change. I can substitute an apple for an orange. The apple can go bad or become rotten and actually disappear, but the number three remains constant. The number three, you might say, has a kind of power that sensible things don't have. And this is the sense in which sensible things are themselves images of higher originals, namely mathematical objects. This is still, I would guess, rather difficult to follow. Numbers, according to Plato, are responsible for sensible things being intelligible. He would argue, and he may well be right, that the world of our senses, the world that comes into our eyes and we feel with our hands, would simply make no sense whatsoever unless we could count. He takes counting very, very seriously. And you'll see in the next couple of lectures that mathematics, arithmetic in particular, will start to gain more and more prominence in Plato's Republic. Once again, mathematical objects, and we'll focus exclusively for an example on numbers, are higher than sensible objects. Sensible objects are images. If this is true, and I would ask you to entertain this possibility for the next few minutes, an extraordinary thing has happened. The sensible world, the world that we normally think of as being real, the world we're most comfortable with, the world which we trust, that's the word that is on the right side of the line corresponding to sensible things, that world that we typically take for granted has become transformed as we moved from C to B. It has become transformed into an image. Go back to the bottom of the line to understand what this means. The shadow is an image of the hand. The hand is more real than the shadow. I know that because if I remove the hand, the shadow disappears. The shadow depends on the hand for its reality. Socrates is making the extraordinary suggestion that the sensible world is like a shadow. It's dependent on a higher form of reality. And in this case, in this particular segment of the divided line, that form of reality is mathematical. This is an extraordinary discovery on Plato's part, and you'll perhaps recall a point I made when I asked you to actually draw the divided line yourself. The two segments of the divided line that are in the middle, B and C, are equal. Regardless of how you divide the line, they always have to be equal. I think this is a point that Plato is trying to communicate. It's a point that was made much, much later by someone like the great physicist Galileo. Galileo famously said, "The book of nature is written in the characters of mathematics." What did he mean by that? He meant, I think, precisely what Socrates means here, that the sensible world, the world that we observe, is itself structured by mathematical principles. The deeper reality of the sensible world is found not in what we can touch with our hands, but what we can think with our minds, and principally what we can think by way of mathematics. Corresponding to mathematical objects on the right side of the line is that word thought. This is how we access reality. Again, a rather puzzling idea that we don't get our basic contact with reality with our senses, we get it with our minds, a fundamental tenet of Platonism. We move up the line. We move from segment B to segment A, from mathematical objects to forms. We've already talked a lot about forms in this course. Here they are at the top of the divided line, although not at the very top, very close to the top. Unfortunately, once again, Socrates is very reticent about the relationship between forms and mathematical objects. But we can infer what he means if, once again, we take our bearings from the bottom of the line. His point, I believe, is this. Mathematical objects, which are the originals of which sensible things are images, are themselves images of forms. Forms are the higher level of reality, the more basic originals of which mathematical objects are merely images. The divided line, in short, is a very compact picture of all of reality. At the top of the ontological hierarchy, ontological is the word that is derived from the Greek word for being, are the forms. I'm not going to try to explain any further the relationship between forms and mathematical objects. This is a theme we will come back to shortly, however. At the very top of the divided line, what do we find? Socrates doesn't quite say it explicitly, but he clearly intends it. This is, of course, the idea of the good. So now, pushing our idea of image and original to the top of the divided line, we can say what? That even forms, the form of beauty, the form of justice, the subject of the Republic itself, even these forms are images of the highest principle of all, the idea of the good. As we know, and we discussed in the previous lecture, we're just not sure what Plato means by the idea of the good. Many commentators throughout the history of philosophy have made a suggestion that's plausible, but certainly not provable, and that is that the idea of the good is what came to be known as the one, the principle of unity. This is an attractive proposal if you think in the following terms. The idea of the one is itself responsible for the possibility of any number. If I have the number three, I can conceive of the number three as three ones. In Greek arithmetic, ancient Greek arithmetic, one was not a number. The first number was two. And that's because in the Greek mind, a number was a number of ones. If I count three apples, an apple is functioning as my unit, and I count one, two, three apples. The unit must come first. And I think this might be the reasoning behind those commentators who believe that the idea of the good is really the one. That before we can even begin to think, either mathematically or in terms of forms, we must begin with the idea, the most basic idea of all, which is the idea of the unit, of oneness. If this is true, then we will identify the one as the ultimate principle responsible for the intelligibility of all of the rest of reality. This is still, needless to say, rather hard to understand. And Socrates appreciates that. One of the great benefits of writing a dialogue, as Plato does, is by giving Socrates a conversation partner, in this case Glaucon, he often will have Glaucon ask questions, the very same questions we readers ourselves would likely ask. And Glaucon doesn't understand everything that Socrates has been saying. Later, and I refer here to 523 C to D, which is in Book 7, the divided line, you recall, occurs at the very end of Book 6. Socrates tries to explain the divided line a little bit more elaborately, and he gives an example. He asks us to imagine three fingers. The pinky finger is the littlest finger, the ring finger is in between, and then the middle finger is the largest finger. You don't have to think about this in terms of fingers. Just imagine, again, you might even want to sketch with pencil and paper, three lines where you go from the shortest to the middle to the longest line. The key point Socrates makes here is that the finger in the middle, and when I say middle, I'm not referring to the middle finger, I'm referring to the in-between finger, the finger that's larger than the smallest and smaller than the largest. That finger, if I simply look at it with my eyes, is both larger and smaller, longer and shorter. Socrates identifies this as a contradiction. This doesn't make sense. How can something be both longer and shorter? His point that he makes in Book 7 is that with my eyes alone, with my senses, I cannot resolve this contradiction. And you can prove this by just looking at those three little lines you drew with a pencil and paper and just focus. First, I look at the middle line in relationship to the smaller and then in relationship to the bigger. And you'll, of course, see exactly what Socrates means. That middle line is both longer and shorter. And that's a contradiction. And a contradiction, according to Socrates, doesn't make sense. Another way to put this point then is that the information we get with our eyes by itself just doesn't make sense. So what do? We need to stabilize, we need to make intelligible what is otherwise unintelligible on the level of sensation. And how do we do it? Very easily, very commonsensically. We measure the three fingers, or the three lines that you've drawn. And we'll say that the smallest is 2 inches long, the middle is 3 inches long, and the longest is 4 inches long. 2, 3, 4 inches. Now, having made that measurement, my otherwise contradictory sensations have been resolved. They've been rendered intelligible. They've been stabilized. What had been unintelligible is now intelligible. This is a way of going back to the divided line and recall what corresponds to sensible things on the right is trust. What we normally trust to be reliable is the information we get from our senses. Socrates' point is that's just not the way it is. What's much more reliable is the way we think about the information we receive from our senses. That primary act of thinking is found in counting, in measuring. By establishing the exact length of the three fingers or the three lines, I am moving upwards from C to B. I'm realizing that numbers are actually more powerful in explaining reality than what I receive through my eyes. This very simple act, utterly commonsensical, is in fact of fundamental philosophical importance for Plato. It suggests the point I made earlier, that the sensible world itself is but an image of a higher reality. Now, let me go back to the observation I made about the geometry of the line, namely that those two middle sections are equal. Once we have moved up from sensible things to mathematical objects, the two segments that are exactly equal in length, there's a very great temptation. It's a temptation we all know. It's the temptation to go back down. The reason why we're so tempted to go back down is because, as we all know, mathematics is so remarkably useful in explaining, even manipulating, the sensible world. If I'm a carpenter and I know a little bit about geometry, I'm able to use that knowledge to help me build a house. If I'm a merchant and I know arithmetic, I can use that knowledge to help me make money. On a vastly more sophisticated level, I will return to my comparison with Galileo. In mathematical physics, I learn my mathematics, I learn the laws of nature, which are mathematical, and I can return to the sensible world and know how it works and be able to manipulate it. This going back down from B to C, I like to think of as intellectual gravity. The weight of thinking seems to pull us downwards precisely because mathematics is so useful in manipulating the sensible world. Socrates gives a word to describe this tendency of thought. He calls it the technai, the arts, the crafts. That word is the root of our word technology or technical. His point then is that technical thinking is the application of mathematics to the sensible world in order to achieve useful, practical results. Again, I would use the phrase intellectual gravity to describe this tendency to move from B to C. The point Socrates wants to make, however, is that the goal of the philosopher is to reverse intellectual gravity and to go upwards rather than downwards. Instead of moving from mathematical objects back down to sensible things, to move upwards from mathematical objects to the forms, to turn around. And I use that phrase with some emphasis because this will become very important in our next lecture when we discuss in some detail the Platonic conception of education. The goal of the philosopher is to resist a temptation. It's the temptation to use the results of thinking to achieve practical results in the sensible world. The name Socrates gives for this upward thrust of intellectual labor is dialectic. You'll see that at 5.11b. The challenge is to go upwards from mathematical objects to the forms, to the very top of the line, the idea of the good, and then, and I'm going to quote 5.11c, to work our way all the way back down the entire line, making no use of anything sensed in any way, but using forms themselves, going through forms, to forms, it ends in forms too. Again, it's very difficult to understand exactly what Socrates means. I've read this passage hundreds of times, and I'm not sure. I will confess that. However, I think at least we can get a sense of what he means. Dialectic is the process of completely reversing intellectual gravity, understanding that even mathematics are merely images of higher intelligible realities, the forms, which themselves are images of the good or perhaps the one. Upon understanding that, working our way down through all the remaining categories or segments of reality and giving an explanation of everything in terms of those higher principles. In short, the divided line seems to offer an image of philosophy itself. It suggests the possibility of a formal articulation of the whole of reality. One clue as to what this might mean in more concrete terms. Let's go back to the very beginning of the Republic when Socrates asks Cephalus what seems to be such a simple question. He asks him, "What is justice?" And we've discussed this idea several times in the course already. That question is a way of looking for the form of justice. That is a question that is seeking a universal definition, an intelligible structure. It's a question which disparages the particulars. The particulars are those individual sensible things that come into being and then pass away, trees and dogs and cats, apples and oranges. Those, in a very important sense, are of little interest to Socrates. What he's interested in is the formal structure, the intelligible structure of reality, and not the particulars that seem to populate reality. That he relegates to the level merely of sense.